apart from cosmetic reasons, it won't create any problems to the patient. There are no other signs and symptoms. But if the patient, see this, in this picture you can see the pinna is abnormally protruding, that we call it the bat ear. So apart from cosmetic deformity, it won't create any problem to the patients. So what if the patient wants correction, it can be surgically corrected by plastic surgery procedures after the age of 6 years. The second congenital anomaly is preauricular appendages. So as we have just discussed, the 6 hillocks, they fuse to form the pinna. If one of the hillock doesn't fuse properly, it will present here as an additional appendage, right, in the vicinity of the externotomy canal. Again, apart from cosmetic reasons, this appendages also won't create any problem to the patient. And if the patient wishes, they can be surgically excised along with its cartilaginous content. That is about preauricular appendage. Now, third is preauricular sinus. So this picture, you can see a small pit-like thing, just anterior where the arrow is pointing. You can see a small pit. Can everyone see that pit? Hello?
Yes, sir.
So this is called as a preauricular sinus. Can anyone tell me definition of sinus? What is sinus and what is the difference between sinus and fistula?
Open at one side, sir.
Okay, the sinus has only one epithelial opening at only one epithelial side. The other side is blind, whereas fistula has connection to the two epithelial surfaces, right? Remember the basic difference. Fistula has connection to the two epithelial surfaces. For example, postoral fistula. Many times if the patient develops mastoid abscess and the abscess bursts out and the area where the pus has come out, that tract may not heal properly, and that will lead to the communication between mastoid cavity and external surface. This we call it the mastoid fistula. So this fistula has communication to the two epithelial surfaces. One is the mastoid epithelium and the other is epithelium over the skin. So the tract connecting two epithelial surfaces open at two epithelial surfaces is called as fistula. Whereas the sinus, like this, for example, this preauricular sinus, it has got only one opening to the skin. The other end is blind, somewhere extending here. So this is called as a sinus. Again, the etiology of preauricular sinus is improper fusion of hillocks forming the pinna. And that's why this sinus forms. Now, the lining of the sinus is commus epithelium, like a skin. Now, what we have understood, basic property of this commus epithelium, that superficial cells are dead and they get shredded into the environment. So that's why the nature has given squamous epithelium on the body, which is exposed to the exterior. There is no squamous epithelium in any part of the human body which is in the closed vicinity. But here what is happening, the tract probably is going like this, right? And this tract is lined by skin or squamous epithelium. Now what will happen, these squamous epithelial cells, what they are, superficial cells, dead cells, they will get accumulated into this tract only. And these epithelial cells will get secondarily infected, and that will lead to the formation of preauricular abscess. That is a very painful condition. It will lead to the swelling into this area, swelling, redness. The swelling will be tender to touch. It will be warm in temperature. And there will be, if you press here, the purulent discharge will come out from this opening. So this, what is the treatment of this preauricular sinus? As this can get infected in future and can create a preauricular abscess, this sinus needs to be excised electively. So we take an elliptical incision like this and we excise all the tract which is extending up to here. So this is a treatment of preauricular sinus. Why it needs to be treated, why it needs to be excised? Because there are chances of the sinus getting infected and it may form a preauricular abscess. That's why it needs to be excised. But if unfortunately the patient develops abscess, then the first step is to drain the abscess, do the IND of the abscess, and in the second stage, through the excision of preauricular sinus. Now the other congenital conditions are anosia, microsia and macrosia. Anosia means the external, the pinna is not developed only. That is anosia. Macrosia means excessively larger pinna, and microsia is small pinna. So this is, here you can see the microsia. These things also can be surgically corrected at the age of 6 years and above by a plastic surgery procedures. So these are the congenital conditions affecting the pinna. Now we will see the traumatic conditions which affect the pinna. Here you can see this part of the pinna is swollen. There is bluish discoloration and you can see an edema here. So if we palpate, this will be fluctuant. There will be fluctuation. It will not be tender initially. So why this part has swollen? Because of collection of blood between the cartilage and skin. That's why this part is swollen. It is non-tender because it is not yet infected. There is just a collection of serous fluid or blood between the skin and the cartilage of the pinna. That we call it as a hematoma of the pinna. What is the cause? Any shearing trauma, shearing force. Suppose you are traveling in a train and somebody's hand get sheared like this to the pinna, or your pinna gets rubbed against wall or something. This leads to the rupture of the vessel in the subcutaneous tissue, and that leads to the formation of blood collected between the skin and the cartilage and swelling of this part of the pinna. This we call it as a hematoma. Now, what is the problem of this hematoma? Initially it's not painful, but there are chances that it may get secondarily infected. Now, many people, they go to the general practitioners, and unknowingly what they do, they try to aspirate this with a needle. They put a needle and they aspirate. For the time being, that blood or collected serous fluid comes out and this skin gets draped to the cartilage. But again, after some time or some days, this blood gets collected. And if these people repeatedly, they keep on aspirating this without taking aseptic precautions, there are chances that it may get secondarily infected, forming to the abscess in this region. Now, in the anatomy, we have seen that the underlying cartilage of the pinna is surviving on the skin for the nutrition. Now, if suppose the collection like this blood or some serous fluid which has lifted up the skin from the underlying cartilage. Now, this cartilage will not get blood supply which it was getting through the skin, and that cartilage will undergo avascular necrosis, and that may lead to the deformity of the pinna. Now, this will take 3-4 days also. But unfortunately, if the abscess forms, the devitalization of cartilage or necrosis of cartilage is very fast. Within 48 hours, the cartilage starts undergoing necrosis. That's why if there is abscess, then it has to be drained immediately. Now, treatment line is same. What we have to do? We have to do incision and drainage under local anesthesia. Incise this much part, drain out all the fluid or pus and give a pressure bandage so that there won't be any dead space which won't allow accumulation of fluid in the area. That about the preauricular sinus, preauricular hematoma and hematoma of the pinna and abscess of the pinna. Now, how will you clinically differentiate between the hematoma and abscess? As I told, now you can see there is a bluish discoloration, but swelling is not too much. In the case of abscess, it will be red, inflamed. It will be tender to touch. Temperature will be raised into the local area. And patient may have a fever, constitutional symptoms, fever, fatigueness, all those symptoms are there. So this is how we differentiate hematoma from the abscess of the pinna.